for Beth. I appreciate the music tonight. Turn with me to two different passages of scripture this evening. The first being Luke chapter number 19. And the second being 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. Luke 19. And let's start at verse number 45. The Bible says, "And he went into the temple and began to cast out them who sold therein and them who bought, saying unto them, It is written, My house is a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. And he taught daily in the temple, but the chief priests and the scribes and the chief of the people sought to destroy him, and they could not find what they might do, for all the people were very attentive to hear him." For all the people were very attentive to hear him. Another way that we could translate this in some other versions, new translated, is, "And all the people hung on his words." Have you ever hung on the words of someone before? You know, whatever they tell you, you hold to that word. You cling to it. Amen. The Bible says that those religious leaders sought to destroy Jesus, and they could not because the people hung on to his words. They were very attentive to every word that he spoke. They couldn't find a loop. They couldn't find a way that they could work against Jesus Christ. Let's see what Paul relates to us as he shares with us the Lord's Supper. 1 Corinthians 11, verse number 23, the Bible says, this was Jesus, he was speaking, and Paul relates, "For I have received of the Lord that which I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do you in remembrance of me. That for the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament and my blood. This do you as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Hanging on to every word that Jesus said. Those who love him, Sister Dietrich, those who follow him, those who trust him, hang on to every word very attentively to what Jesus says. Has anyone ever heard that old phrase, that old commercial, that old line that says, "When E.F. Hutton speaks..." Remember that? What is it? Everybody listens. That's right. I remember growing up and hearing that. When E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens. Amen. Better than that, when Jesus begins to talk and speak, people listen intently. He drove out the merchants that were selling goods in the temple area, and he began to teach. Amen. And as he taught, the Word of God says that he taught as one that had authority. Amen. The Word of God has authority tonight. Mm-hmm. When we read it, there is authority for us to live our life by. And an amazing thing that the people... people were attentive to hear him. They hung on, or they clung to every word. Amen. They came to the temple early in the morning to hear him. And he amazed them as he taught without authority. Amen. So as we look at what Jesus speaks and what he teaches, amen, they were his followers. They were listening to every word. Amen. They knew that what Jesus had to say would preserve them through the ages. And what he has to say has still lasted through the ages. He's still God with all authority.
Amen.
And he speaks still to you and I through his word.
Amen.
Thank God for that. Not only is it what will preserve us and that we need to hang on to, but we need to share with others. There's a few things, and tonight, I know that some of this is not fresh to you. It's things that you're very aware of. But Jesus said that he was the bread of life. And he explained it this way. Sister Dietrich, he said, your fathers, they ate manna that was sent from God, but yet they died. They ate manna, they went out every day, they collected it, but yet they died. He said, but I am the bread of life, that when you eat of me, you shall never die. He was speaking something that was so important, that if you eat of me, if you eat the bread of who I am the light and the life of the world. And if you eat of me, you will never die. I need to tell you, this evening we need to be attentive to hang on to the words of Christ. That when we eat of him, we will never die. Amen. The spiritual man will not perish. Amen. But we'll move on. Amen. To a better day with him.
Amen.
Praise God for that. He is the bread of life. But his body would be broken. As he took up that bread, that unleavened bread, and he picked it up, Sister Jenny, he began to talk to his disciples. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. He who was whole became broken, that we who are broken could become whole. That we could eat of him, and we would never die again. He is the bread of life. Tonight, as we're going to get ready to have communion here in a few moments, hang on to the words, for it is. He's the bread of life. He is life and life everlasting.
Mm-hmm.
And Brother Doug, when we eat of him, Brother Justin, we will never die. He said that without his blood, that we have no life. I tell you the truth, he said, unless you eat of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, and John, he said, you won't have a life. But whosoever, putting this in my terms this evening, eats of that bread and drinks of that blood, amen, would have eternal life. And Jesus said that he would raise them in the last day. Amen. So when we hang on to the words that Jesus spoke, and we take of communion, we think of his body that was broken and his blood that was given. And when we participate of him and we take of him, and yes, it's just a tangible piece of bread and it's some grape juice that we're going to drink as representative of that. But it is a reminder in our minds and in our hearts that we hang and hold attentively to the words that Jesus spoke, that when we spiritually eat and drink of him, we have life and life more abundantly. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said that he was the way and he was the truth and he was the life, that no one got to God except by him. He was the vine and we were the branches. And if we would abide in him, amen, and remain in him, we would have fruit, amen, and nothing would take us apart from him. But coming to him and abiding in him means eating and drinking of him.
Mm-hmm.
I keep going back to the well of salvation. Sister Barbara, there's something about the well and the water that is alive. I keep coming back to the table and eating of the bread of life. When life is exhausting, when seasons change, those around us change and our environments change, the one consistency we have in life is Christ.
Amen.
I'm not a real big person of change. Not, it's necessary, and yes, to advocate that there's going to be change. There is going to be change. Life is full of change, but there's a lot of change I don't like. But I'm glad in the middle of change, Sister Susan, that my consistency is Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. So I must eat and drink of Him who is the bread of life. There's something that Paul talked about. When we take of the Lord's Supper, the Bible says, that we should examine ourselves. We do a couple things with the Lord's Supper, and that is we look back to Calvary. I had this evening to sit down and begin to read in the book of Matthew, chapter number 27. The Word of God says, and when they were come to that place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of the skull, the Bible says that now the sixth hour there came darkness over the land until the ninth hour. Do you know that when we look back at Calvary, Sister Dietrich, it wasn't dark because there was a lunar eclipse and the moon took over. That wasn't what happened here. It was dark because God the Father could hardly stand, could not stand to see His Son take upon Himself the sins of the world. Brother George, I think about the guilt that I would carry for my life, and my life is minimal compared to a lot of folks. Not that I'm saying I'm any better sin as sin. But for every person, Sister Tina, Jesus Christ took on the penalty of sin. God the Father just could not stand to see His Son. And there in the darkness, Jesus hung as He took on the sins of the world. We're looking back. Because every sin that you and I ever committed in our life, Jesus Christ took the penalty for it on Calvary. Mm-hmm. The love of God. How rich and true. How measureless and sure tonight. If the oceans were ink and the skies were parchment, you could never, ever, ever exhaust writing the love of God. The songwriter said, can you imagine God's love? And that's what we're celebrating. That's what we're remembering as we look back on what Jesus did for us on Calvary. There He was 3 hours, and then He cries out, that Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, amen, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That is what we're remembering tonight, that even the Father couldn't stand to see His Son bear the sins. Talk about love. Talk about grace. Talk about an amazing story. That is what communion is about, that God loved us so much that He sent His only begotten Son, even though He couldn't stand to see Him bear the penalty of sin. Oh, Jesus cried out. Straightway, the Bible says that one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar, put on a reed and gave it to him to drink. Then the Bible says that he cried out with a loud voice. We know from the other Gospels, and he cried out, it is finished. Mm-hmm. I know this is a newsflash to you because I've said it before. But he didn't say, I'm finished. He said, it is finished. The work that you've called me to do, it is finished. And then he gave up the ghost. He died. God died for me. He chose to die because he chose to love. He chose to forgive. He chose to give life and life more abundantly. The veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom. The presence of God was no longer concealed behind a veil, but because of the work of Christ on the cross, you and I can feel the Holy Ghost that we're feeling tonight. Amen. That is what communion is about. Hang on to every word. Amen. What are the words? It is finished. The work is done. Amen. The price has been paid. Atonement has been brought. Propitiation for sins. It is now achieved. Amen. I've done the work.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That is what we're remembering tonight. So we look back to Calvary. But it's also an opportunity to look into ourselves. Amen. And we examine ourselves. Amen. To make sure that we're worthy to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Amen. Of the Lord. Amen. That means how we've been living right. Now we've been acting right. Now we've been doing our best to honor God. Amen. It's a time of examination. And as we examine, as we look within, is there anything, God, that I've said or done or an action or an attitude? God, forgive me because I never want to drink this cup and eat of this bread unworthily. One employer was said to have done this. In Tucson, Arizona, as he was interviewing people, as they first come in, above a full-lit mirror, he had posted, would you hire this person? So they come in and full-lit mirror for Sister Dietrich, they see themselves, would you hire this person, Sister Nancy? Look at yourself. And then they would go for the interview part. And as they would go, they would walk by another mirror that was in the office. And it said, are you ready for the job? You know what he was doing? He was setting that up as a self-examination for who was ready for the job. That's what Christ has done. Set it up for self-examination. That are you ready for the day when we shall sit in His kingdom and eat of this bread and drink of this cup? Communion is a time to examine our hearts. And then it's a time that we can look outward. And we can thank God for our brothers and our sisters, who someday we will sit in heaven with and partake of the bread and the cup. Life would be awful lonely if God had not given us our brothers and our sisters. And it would be very sad, Brother George, to think we'd just go to heaven to be alone. God didn't make it that way. Because Sister Beth, He so designed that whatsoever people we have or whatever season, that if they sleep in the Lord, our hope is this, that we do not grieve as others which do not have hope. But we have a hope of one day sitting down round about the throne of Jesus and partaking of that cup. How wonderful that was, Christ. To be able to see the one who died for us. To be able to drink of that cup and eat of that bread, knowing that it is life and life more abundantly. and we see just people and people and people, people and people who've experienced the same breath and the same blood which we have. Some will be from the Old Testament and some will be from the New Testament. Some will be through ages that we have not known. And some will be some of the dearest folks that we were privileged to share some of the most precious moments in this life with. All because of the body and the blood that brings us together in the kingdom of God.
If Sister Beth would come to the piano tonight. Examination is a good thing for us to do. We look back to Calvary. We look within ourselves. We look outwardly to those who we are with and know that someday we'll be together in eternity. Amen. We continue in the faith. And we look ahead to know that we're going to be with Jesus. That's what communion is about. D.L. Moody was asked, he said, if the Lord would return tonight and you knew it, how would you live your life? D.L. Moody looked at that person. He said, I wouldn't do anything any differently than I do every day. You know why? Because he partook of the bread and the blood regularly. He ate of Jesus Christ. And so it allowed him to keep his life where it needed to be. Tonight, as we get ready together, and look back at Calvary. Take time to look inside. Even look around about to others that are here with you. And then look ahead to know that one day we're going to take of this cup with Jesus. Amen. Would you gather in around about these altars? Find yourself a place of prayer, whether kneeling or sitting, whatever is best for you. But come before God and examine your hearts as we get ready to take communion tonight. Let's hang on to every word of Jesus tonight.